And I look around these things and like, how would, you know, a survivalist, a scout, a tracker, you know, how would they make it in this place? And the answer is, like, if there was just a few of us, they'd make it very well, and it'd be great. But if you try to have a whole village here, much less, you know, feed any sort of populations that are nearby in a large metropolitan area, you know, there's a whole different story. And one thing to consider is that when the natives did live here in this area, they heavily managed it. They managed these manzanita trees to make more berries through various practices, largely fire. If you did have to do it here, like, what would be your diet? So there would be, like, your transitional diet, and then there would be, you know, your ideal diet, what would you grow? So I like to think of, you know, like, permaculture systems and permaculture guilds and ecological design, and how would, if I did decide to live here, how would I feed myself? And most, like, survivalist diets aren't going to sustain you long term, and they're not going to sustain generations. So let's start out with what you got. You have, in this area, you've got the number one food source is acorns. It's the number one food source for the wildlife, and it was for the natives that lived here too. And it's the highest calorie, and, you know, lots of nutrition. And the acorn crops around here are pretty big. You have the blue oaks, you have, this year we have some black oak acorns, and then the valley oaks. Last year was a huge year for the blue and valley oaks. In fact, I still have some saved over from last year, and they probably last another year. We'll have to see. So that's the good news. Except that, you know, there's not really that many trees. There's definitely more acorns and big ears than all the animals can eat. So that's one thing. Another thing we have is around here we have gray pines. And gray pines make a very nutritious and very delicious seed. And make it in pretty big quantities. And another thing we have are these lovely manzanitas. And these manzanitas, especially when they're managed properly, produce a pretty huge crop of berries. And with manzanita berries, it's all in the processing. So I think, like, you eat them usually when they're dried, and that's when they're ripe. And then you can crush them into, like, a meal, and you can make a drink out of that, which is delicious. But perhaps you could also crush that into, like, acorn gruel to make it, you know, extra flavor. And so you have stinging nettles. There are a few patches of nettle around here. They would definitely have to be enhanced, you know, implanted in other areas. We have rose, so rose hips are very valuable. Another thing that I don't really see around here, but I know it does exist in the park, is grapes. And grapes not only are, you know, have a lot of nutrition and can store and be dried fruit, raisins, but they also have seeds, and those seeds you can extract an oil, and they do have some protein and some nutritional value. So how would we use grape seeds in our, you know, nutritional guild from the plants that we have available? And of course, you've got blackberries and toyon berries, and then there's bay nuts. So one of the things that, you know, when I do these dreaming of these permaculture systems and these local ecologies, the thing that's usually missing is fat. So, you know, if I were going to stay here and this be my food shed, where would I get my fat? Traditionally, the people here, they had got a lot of fat from animals. And some of that, I'm sure, was salmon. And also the waterfowl. You know, every year there would be huge migrations of waterfowl that passed over, and they would render, like, duck fat, basically, from them. And now it's in a great source of fat. And then there is some fat in the acorns and the bay nuts. And I think those would be, you know, your big sources of fat. So here we have wild boar. But the thing to see that's missing is, like, the waterfowl and the salmon. There's this huge missing element of the ecology. Not only are the plants not producing like they once were because they haven't been managed for, you know, 150, 200 years in the way that they were for thousands of years by the natives here, but the animal populations are gone. For one, we could use elk before. There are no elk here. There are no salmon. There are no waterfowl anymore. So all of those food sources are gone. And so we'd have to figure something else out. Like, well, how would we get the fat if we did have to live here now as opposed to before? And, you know, I would say, well, we could bring in cows, possibly. But how about goats? Maybe you could bring in goats for goat milk. But then you'd have to sort of shepherd them and manage them, whatever. I think another great source of fat would be from olives. Olive trees do grow here, and they grow well here. And that'd be a great thing to look at. So it's not just what native plants already grow here and what native plants grew here, but it's what plants that we brought with us that we can use that really help make it sustainable. Like, there's a feral apple that I saw up the hill. and propagate that. You know, apples are an extremely valuable food source. There's all kinds of things. I mean, you know, if you had access to any sort of water, you know, grow some potatoes, keep some chickens. That's a good source of protein and calories in those foods. Another thing, you know, you look at is like digging swales on the hillsides. So a lot of places here, there's not a lot of food production and there's not a lot of animals there because of that. And the reason is because there's no water. And so it gets very little rain here. And when it does rain, it mostly just runs down and runs off as fast as it can. And so if you dug swales on the hillsides, you would catch that rain, and you wouldn't necessarily have to plant it with anything, but you could. You could plant it with, you know, oak trees, but you could also plant it with, like, apples and things that aren't as represented in ecology already. So, I mean, the idea basically is here's how can you make as much food as naturally as possible that sustains biodiversity and sustains you nutritionally. What would you work to do is bring back the huge populations of waterfowl, and you work to bring back the salmon, and you work to bring back the elk. And so then you have those things. But in the meantime, you have to figure something else out, because we can't bring those things back overnight. And I think that if we're looking to bring those things back in for food, I think it gives a lot more motivation. It doesn't seem so hopeless, and it seems more exciting to lots of people, but I think the most important part is it actually intimately connects you in a way that you were meant to be connected to those things instead of, you know, people...